invested in education, invested in the welfare of the community. And in fact, you know, the impact of such interests were noted by noted French visitor when he made the democracy in America observations, Francis talked about. He noticed that where he traveled, the values, arts, and interests, largely from, you know, religious education of the family, but were held up by women. And this was absolutely marvelous to him, because in France, folks who contributed to these things were leisure class of nobility. And here was, you know, in the new country, United States of America, thought was one of the most wonderful things he witnessed. So, you know, your whole barrels were right there. And, you know, as was mentioned earlier, also my connections to AAUW was established during my, I believe it was junior year, in a way of what is now would be a small scholarship, but it was $100. But those were days when tuitions were $100,000. So it was most appreciated. And I also, beyond that, appreciated the gentle push behind me from a group of women who were interested in my education. The spirit of it I carry since then. And of course it goes well with the strong spirit in that direction of my deceased mother. You know, in Japan, education is very important. So, oh, one more appendage. My daughter, who was going to be in attendance, I'm not sure who she is. Oh, there she is. Her internship during, you know, her earlier education, she's in medical school right now, was with the headquarters of AAUW in Washington, D.C., sent from Wellesley. So when she heard that, you know, I was speaking to this group, oh, mother! Now to the topic of this morning, a role of hope in contemporary society. Contemporary, we could probably have agreement, is meaning now or current scene. And you might also have a consensus that the scenes around the world in a contemporary society are quite worrisome. What with political and religious dissensions of global magnitude, not showing any signs of ameliorating. I hope I got that R and M right. It comes in one word, it goes on everyone. To say it right. I was going to say amazing, but it didn't mean quite what I wanted to say. How better now? Wait, you think that this is contemporary scene? Way back in when the chronicler of Peloponnesian, now that's another word, war, Thucydides, observed, let's see, I say it right, said, there is a tide in the affairs of men. The strong takes what they can, and the weak suffer what they must. And in the same vein, a little later, well, much later, in the middle of the 16th century, the author of The Social Contract, Thomas Hobbes, points to the fear being man's primal motivation. you know, making her really able to kill in preservation of himself and defense of his own survival interests. And in our own times, you know, long before September 11 or Iranian or North Korean threats, our major cities being the targets for harms by a small band of terrorists have been forewarned by an American Prometheus, Robert Oppenheimer. He said that the, precisely what some, lots of folks are now worried about, but silenced in the era of Cold War onset. These thoughts, however distasteful to us, are based in reality. Peloponnesian Wars in ancient Greece, if you read that, left very little that we have not seen in the modern warfare, minus the advanced killing technology. All the contrary morals you will note in that chronicle, not left out. Thomas Hobbes' fear, a very gripping fear, was also rooted from the very start of his coming into this world, as his mother was giving birth to him in London. They were being bombarded by Spanish Armada. The huge, resounding, deafening sounds of the cannons were dropping all over London, and she had to air through it, and he was born. You know, early imprinting, in fetus they talk about, this was really real. And he had a sense of this encounter with violent death, apparently, throughout his life, like it was his second nature. And Oppenheimer, more than anybody else, knew what the reality of the consequences of the nuclear warfare could be, and had reasons to forewarn the Americans. So they were very much rooted in the historical reality. What about the notion of hope then? There are a few different approaches to that and definitions. And I think the most common one is to look at hope like a beacon of light, you know, a lighthouse there. Very inspiring. And this is also very telling and helpful, in especially in days when people are you know, feeling discouraged. Take for example, 2 years after Hiroshima was destroyed by the bomb explosion, there was a contest, of course, throughout the province of Hiroshima. And that's like your state, you know, our province. Divided. And the Hiroshima province decided high school kids will sing and compete. And we could have a free selection, but there was one compulsory selection. And I remember it was Whispering Hope. Well, you know that song.
Yes.
And, but the children didn't know the reality of hope in their day-to-day lives. You know, in those days, our textbooks were widened out at the order of headquarters of Allied forces, that anything to do with traditional values were not to be, you know, repeated. So, but without knowing really what it meant to look to the new future, we sang and sang heartily, practiced and practiced. So end result of it was, I think throughout my subsequent life, I knew Whispering Home in Japanese by heart. And with your permission, maybe you'd like to hear what it sounds like in Japanese. It goes something like this. Amatsumitsu koi no koe mo sayakari Hiko sasayaku no tsumi no koto wa. So you see what I mean? And my husband will attest to you, well, you know, I don't know, sometimes she sings that. That's what he said. I said, you know, I think he stayed in my mind all my life. And he says, you know, that's right. Okay. Then there is a notion of hope as that of hell. Most a profound to me thinker of a modern times puts it. And his is a little different than the vegan out there. He says, hope is something that makes sense to you so much that it doesn't matter how it turns out. And this came, I was reading in his speech that he gave, acceptance speech, in a Future of Freedom conference that was held in December of 1995 in Hiroshima. They really, you know, were interested in that as they were, you know, struggling to really become a center of peace in the world. And I, as I understand it, he was imprisoned for extended period under then a dictator, okay, thank you. And he had a particularly, I guess, sadistic keeper, and he, you know, he was a dissident freedom fighter, and that's how he was imprisoned and incarcerated. Off and on, probably like 15 years, but just straight out without relief for 5 years or so. And he was in such despair. You know, what's the point? So I tried so hard, you know, tried to be in a right direction for himself. And he was close to committing suicide, and I suppose if you were really determined, you could do that anywhere. But then he hit upon, come to believe this notion, that something made so much sense to you that it didn't really make any difference how it turned out. And as you know, when the Czechoslovakia was liberated, he was the first freely elected president of Czechoslovakia. He held on to it. And people recognized it, that he did.
Okay.
If we subscribe to this notion of hope, there are endless possibilities, unending possibilities. And I right away thought about the people of La Chambon, I'm sure I'm butchering the pronunciation, of France. You know, these are villages up in the mountains who saved hundreds and thousands of Jewish children and refugees right during and under the nose of Nazi occupation. believing when I read the account of this. In the ancient text called the Bible, that called these folks the chosen people. And they were determined to give shelter and protection to the chosen people. And it's kind of hard to believe, you know, in the climate that the people were surrounded with an untold number of victims, just as in today, in our contemporary world, encounter. And I'll give you another example closer to my home, in the person of Marcel Junot, Swiss surgeon, who was sent to Japan as a relief operations officer by the Red Cross shortly after the war ended. And and that was because of his many years of experience in the similar capacity, you know, China, Ethiopia, elsewhere. So he got ready and he sent a dispatch to Hiroshima, seeing what the situation was. And here is the telegram he received on September 2nd, 1945. You know, Hiroshima was destroyed on August 6th, Nagasaki was destroyed on August 9th, and a surrender was signed August 15th. So this is a few or so weeks after, close to a month. And it read, I quote, "Situation horrifying, conditions indescribable, bomb effects mysterious, death still occurring in great numbers. Appeal to High Commander. Ask for supplies to be parachuted immediately into center of town. Immediate action necessary." So the doctor turned immediately to High Command and was promptly requested, was declined. Then the order was that no aid was to be given to the sick and the dying in Hiroshima. They were to be left alone to Dr. Juno. This was unconscionable. Aware the invasion prepared forces would be amply stocked with medical supplies, that you would have lost one life from military force doing that to give humanitarian aid. So he had to resort to some other ways, and he tried very hard to, and I suppose, you know, his own presence might have been questioned at this point if he was doing otherwise other than the order he was given from the army that was securing the country. But I suppose it occurred to him that he had to worry about that. And he tried very hard to go over this hurdle. And finally got some limited supplies, which were shipped to Hiroshima first, immediately, as soon as he could. And miracle of his gift of hope really made a difference. And one such recipient's story made a great impression on me. It was a 19 or 18, she may be younger. She was a young schoolgirl who was pinned under school bill. And with great difficulty as she came out, because she had been pinned under, her leg was severely injured. And of course, there were no well-equipped place to be carrying injured at that point. She was in a resting place, you know, where she could rest. No really medicine, medical aid, or care person, or food, or anything. But I think her mother came over, who probably didn't have much food either. And the injury side became very quickly infected and gangrenous, which meant that if she needed to stay alive, her thigh had to be cut off, done. There were, of course, no surgical instruments, and the only thing available was an ordinary saw. And, because there were no medications, it had to be done without any pain. So she remembered this horrible ordeal of the night when someone who could handle the saw, not any specialized person, but, most men are sort of like more handy. I'm sure these were men rather than women. I can't imagine any woman being able to do it. So her leg off, and she screamed in pain all night, during, after. And there were no bandages to cover the sign of the wound. So her mother tore a part of the kimono wrap and then, covered the wound. And it was at this life or death juncture she felt, point of wanting to be alive if life is like this. And it didn't make any difference to her, and she was, gone. Dr. Janon, fresh white bandage arrived. And she said it was a sight of this white bandage, and that it, helping her, gave her the sense that she had lost of somebody cared about what was happening, and felt like a person again. And from that moment on, she was determined. She's not going to make this discovery and the feeling vain if she will make it count. She became an oral historian of her own experience and the fact life is so precious that you have so much to give to it, that you have to be so prepared to show that the caring made no difference and that life can be so meaningful, even though it could be destroyed just like this. And you know what she did throughout her life? And she had multiple sign cancer, so she was often hospitalized. But even from the hospital bed, if she felt well enough, she went to visit schools, she showed up in meetings, the grassroots oral historian and peace-loving effort, until she passed away. It was just miraculous what she did and the endurance that she had to do that. But, it meant so much to her. And the people who were sending may not have. I remember seeing in the television program her giving a little plant. This came from a tree that was burnt down, but somehow later on little saplings came. I want you to have it, to Dr. Janot's son. And I thought that was really worth sharing with you as a hope, a kind of hope that back of heaven was speaking about. I can give you any more numbers of this sort from my own experience, but for the interest of time, I like to bring you to something that's very close, much closer to us than my experiences in Japan, actually, from this valley. And this is how the story began, is that one wintry night in 2004, during the rehearsal singing songs of peace at the Rogue Valley Peace Choir, I started to lead. And it was a sense of gratitude. There are people who care enough to sing songs of peace. And so hardly, you know, it was such energy. I just was so moved and I started to cry and said to myself, you know, like, this is Fujikawa, the doctor, you know, I have to take this sound to Japan and let them hear it, especially the generation who had gone through war. Because the scene and the image of America was so much, you know, balanced on the side of image of mind. And I thought that it's only fair to have a balanced sort of image. You know, right sometimes make mind. And you have to think about that very thoughtfully. But this is the United States of America. You know, it has so many wonderful fundamental thoughts and interests and strength and force and character. And I wanted to take this sound to Japan. So I talked to the conductor, who was very open to it, and then the chairman and then the membership. And the first, it was a trickle number and who, at one point, over 50 signed up to go to Japan. And a wonderful, heroic efforts of the, you know, people who had signed up for fundraising and campaign, believing in this. 38 of us were able to leave last year for Japan. And quick summation of this trip is, if I may read it, I sent to a mail tribune that came out in November last year. Some 38 ordinary people in Rogue Valley exercised their choice to travel this summer to Japan to sing songs of peace in Kyoto, Kobe, and Hiroshima, taking part in the 61st memorial of the bomb. The results were not only astounding, but also mutually transforming. The sick were comforted, and the young and old in tears spoke of an experience of their lifetime, being moved by a soft and healing sound. We sang at the mound where 70,000 unidentified victims ashes are buried, my mother's included, reserved only for the survivors to give testimonials. I, a survivor, gave my testimonials for the American decency that dared to confront this chapter of our history as they stood with me. Now let me bring the whole content closer to you by taking you to some of the poignant scenes. Japanese very famous glee club called Shingetsukai agreed to have a joint concert with us. And so they said, what would you like to sing together? And I said, beautiful song that these choir men sing called Tenting Tonight. It's a Civil War song, you know. And it was very metaphoric to me, wishing to look at, you know, enough is enough, let's just sort of kind of think of life and living. Among the Americans who from the Peace Corps, you can tell because they're wearing white. It was when we had the same, we wear white, both men and women. Was a man who turned 80 on July 4th in early July, who was also on board a Navy ship when they entered Tokyo Bay. anchored next to Missouri, upon which the surrender was signed. And you know, so that if the war continued on, some of these men would not have been here. And it was very meaningful to me. So listen to the sound of this blended voice of America and Japan in collective healing. Experience that a friend of mine told me there was a third or fourth stage cancer patient who was encouraged to come if she could come. And she came and she said she felt so healed. You know, you can feel so spiritually healed even though physically not completely healed or anything. And she experienced that everything, so many people were so hardened and was given.
Gift of hope. We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome. So may the day.
Now, next one I want you to come to took place in the Peace Park on the evening of August 6th. And this is a peace journey of my daughter and I within the big peace journey that we made. And I hope I'm not embarrassing her. her perspective and mine have small differences. But you know that about that. So what happened was, she, you know, has been living in the Bay Area, but when she found out about this, she was very interested in being a part. And my husband, who was very fond of her singing, wanted her to participate. We were also singing as well. And she helped us out as a soloist. And she had a long classical vocal training, so she sings beautifully. And might not be able to tell it from this one, because it was a very emotional scene for her. She wrote a poem dedicated to my mother, who fell as a victim to the bomb explosion on that day. And she, you know, was never able to give her hug, kisses, or come to her birthday parties, which she missed growing up. But she found out that indeed, you know, my mother did exist. And so I think that she may have felt a spiritual presence, but never met her. And finally, you know, she sang once on the stage in a Hiroshima Mission School concert prior to that, but came to this park where there is a, you know, a mound, memorial mound. And we stood there. You know, it's not reserved for outside visitors to come and do anything, but I was able to secure that privilege. So we were standing not too far from the mound, and I imagine my mother's ass was there. You know, it was never directly identified. The answers were coming to. And so she was singing there, feeling, and prior to that she had gone to the museum to see, you know, different things displayed there. And then there's also a memorial prayer building practically underground for reflection, where you can go and then in the computer, feeding the data, she could see the picture of my mother. And, you know, of course, I sent the picture. But anyway, I was occupied with so many duties that day, so she went with some of my Japanese friends. So on her own, she encountered Hiroshima and her grandmother. And another then is now seeing her. And it's for your benefit, my friend Estelle Hall in the back, and her son was so kind to put the words on the screen so you could see for sure what she was singing, and I wanted you to have that.
Thank you.
So she tells me there were presence of spirit. She could feel it there. And she met my mother in her soul. And to me, she really found also her identity as her grandmother and my daughter. It was all about legacies. And of course, you know, I mean, as a sort of like instinctive reaction, I had to go to her when I felt she was under so much distress. And here is, I think, what I can share with you is that there is a metaphor for life. We are both alive. And I, with all my creaky bones and few chronic problems, have feisty enough spirit to go on. And to show you that after a disaster can be a very followed by creative cycle, just like the province of Hiroshima put the whispering hope on us. No explanation letters, just you sing this song. But we didn't quite understand it. But now, this life human experiences, I can see the ongoing cycles that can be possible as we know who we are and decide what matters most to you inside. To the extent, most of the time we do care how it turns, but there are some things, as I do believe, as now in collective healing, from all war wounds and from even that side of inglorious nature given to us for survival reasons and hope. In the word of Lin Yutan, is a poet, philosopher, teaches on the Harvard, says, hope is like a road in a country. There never was a road, but when many people walk on it, the road comes into existence. Thank you for your time. My mother, unfortunately, was called upon for city, asking each family in our area to send someone to the center. They were engaged, both the school children and the, you know, women and all folks, who were the only thing in the name, were called out to tear down the houses that were evacuated, so the incendiary won't make it a kindred wound. What good it did, you know, if it made any difference here.
That you were, so she was in the center?
Yes, my mother was at the center. A little over a mile.
May I say that in the wonderful book that she has written, all this is talked about and explained.
Yeah, I mean, that was one of the hopes that when I wrote the book, that some of the answers could be given by folks interesting enough to read.